The new Tesla Model 3 is finally here. Take a look at this. Holy moly. Did you like that montage I put together from the official material? This Tesla Model 3 refresh absolutely killed it for a typical mid-generation update. Your typical car maker would make some minor revisions to the interior and exterior during a refresh, but that's simply not good enough for Tesla. Tesla have actually claimed to change up to 50% of the parts from the current gen Model 3.
No way.
Yes, that's half the parts are a brand new design, with the sole aim of premium up, remember that phrase, for just a moment, it's a reoccurring theme. Therefore, the Project Highland Model 3 wasn't exclusively about cost savings, but introducing a greater premium touch to an arguably already great car. This brings me to today's video. To put it simply, some of you will know I put out videos prior to the announcement of the new Model 3, and now it's finally been announced. Naturally, I feel like I've ignored my wife and my kids over the past week and watched, read and absorbed what I feel is every hands-on review on YouTube at least. To my surprise, there are so many changes not receiving the airtime that they truly deserve, whether they are small and handy or just big and better. Therefore, this is my roundup of all the changes plus what features aren't being discussed enough. Plus my two cents on a potentially controversial, but my middle ground opinion on a stalkless Model 3. And whilst the stalks will be missed, is it really that bad that they're gone? So before I kickstart the video, I'd appreciate it if you could just drop the video a cheeky like, subscribe, hit the notification bell. Right, time to hit the new Tesla Model 3 information bonanza.
Can't wait.
I can't wait either.
Starting with the exterior changes. No one is talking about the length and the width of the car has increased ever so slightly, and I'll pop the official measurements on the screen for you to compare, but even the ground clearance is slightly lower too. The reason they probably made the decision was because it was crucial to make drag coefficient improvements to make it the most efficient Model 3 yet. This is not the most efficient Tesla to date, as some have been saying. That accolade very much remains with the Tesla Model S. More on the positive effects of the bigger Model 3 later for the interior. The whole front bumper is more aggressive, as is the new headlights, which I believe incorporate the fog lights. You may remember that these were towards the bottom of the front bumper, and that part has been merged and just deleted into the history books. One feature that I'm extremely keen to see in person is the deliberate dip in the car bonnet, and this was made to encourage the airflow up and over the windshield of the car, and thus allowing for less drag and wind noise to the cabin. And whilst finding it hard to see in a video, but I did come across this image on X, and I feel I can see it best via this image. Let me know in the comments below if you agree. The side repeater cameras actually look like they've been pushed in, or they've receded quicker than my hairline. A sad but true story. They've also introduced a lung beauty line, I think it's called, but it's evident that it's literally been designed to carry the airflow better to the rear of the car from that side repeater camera. The tyres have been changed to Hankooks with a focus solely on range and efficiency, and this actually forced Tesla to reduce the top speed figures. But frankly, that change will affect, what, 1-2% of owners that can legally drive that fast? Acceleration times are seemingly unaffected by this change. A special shout out to the new aero covers. Damn, dubbed Proton, they look sexy as standard. They have some new alloy wheels underneath that look like a solid 7-8, but whilst I admire the difference, I do think the original 18-inch rims probably fare better in looks than these new ones. But that's just a personal opinion. I don't hate the new ones, they're just literally different. The new Proton aero covers and even the 19-inch rims are head above shoulders better though. A solid 9 from me. Finally, the rear of the car has introduced a more Model Y-like diffuser with lights that incorporate the braking and reverse lights, rather than just being a reflector as before. And this is probably in the name of safety, as the light unit will actually travel up when the boot slash the trunk lifts. The new rear and edgy back lights may have a sneaky reliability solution too. The old lights had a weak spot for water ingress buildup. With this revised design, will we actually see an end to that issue? Focusing on the suspension and range now, Tesla has made some cool changes to the suspension to make the ride even smoother than before. And CarWow did a pretty cool off-the-cuff experiment with their hands-on video and was a fairly big improvement within the cockpit. I managed to track down some high-quality images as well to show you what the new suspension looks like. The batteries are apparently unchanged for the rear wheel drive Model 3 and the long range Model 3, but strangely, there wasn't an announcement on the performance Model 3, so maybe that could be a different picture for another video. But without the different batteries, the range has still received a big boost. The Model 3 rear wheel drive will now go almost 50 miles further at 353 miles WLTP range, which just tends to be ever so slightly more generous than EPA ratings. The long range Model 3 is now a monstrous 423 miles. And this is all down to the reduced drag from the changes to the front of the car and the lower ground clearance, as even the motors are apparently the same. This is very Tesla, doing more with less. And so without ramming in bigger battery packs, that means you'll get further in distance for less cost. So in theory, this Model 3 should cost you around 10 to 15% less to run than before. And it was already wildly cheap to run against petrol cars before. If you haven't switched to electric yet, this is probably time to research the clear cost advantages, and I'll just pop a video in the corner of the screen to help. Turning our heads to the vast interior changes and the boot. This is where Tesla looks like it's gone back to the drawing board and fully utilized that premium up attitude. And boy, does it show. The boot, whilst it looks the same, you now have two deep pockets behind the wheel arch. The current Gen 1 only had one, because I believe the subwoofer was actually located in there if you had the long range. That's now been moved to the actual top of the partial shelf. And if you have a rear wheel drive Model 3, congratulations, you now gain a subwoofer. Long range Model 3 customers also gain an extra subwoofer, so now they have two. A massive change to the boot mechanism deserves some credit from me, at least. They've replaced a single gas strut that it used to have with another electric motor, and this will improve how smoothly it operates with a cleaner close. From experience, my motor failed previously, and so taking a ticket out of the Model Y, having two electric motors seems like a no-brainer now. Even the inside of the boot lid now has carpet, and this change is probably down to sound dampening properties to reduce the road noise entering the cabin. That's just simply attention to detail. Right into the heart of the car, the interior, this still looks like a Model 3, but it definitely has received some Model S features and aesthetic design qualities. LED lighting is new and customizable. Am I raving over that? No, not really. Whilst it's customizable, you can apparently turn it off should it be too gimmicky for you. I wonder if there's actually a good practical use for it. Could it pair up with this software feature that says blind spot awareness? Maybe part of the LED near the side mirrors could just light up. I don't know. The steering wheel is at least a typical wheel, and that makes a lot of people happy because it isn't a yoke. However, nabbing a Model S feature, it's now gone stalkless, and so all your stalk features, including indicating, is now on the steering wheel. Now, for us Brits and some European nations, we have roundabouts, and so that does make a few people uneasy on the practicality side of it. Will I miss stalks? Yes. However, whilst roundabouts are common here, critically thinking, is the concerns around roundabout usage overhyped? Potentially so. Thinking about how often I actually turn right and then immediately indicate left over the course of a week's worth of driving, it's probably just a handful of times. And whilst I'm not ignorant to the concerns raised, I think you're not going to be in that awkward situation whereby the wheel is upside down and then you struggle to indicate a second time very often at all. Yes, there will be some adjustment to it, maybe taking it slow around the roundabouts until the comfort and the confidence is there, but ultimately only time will tell. Tesla has done the testing on this even in Europe. The real test of time will be the people that use it day to day. That is when we'll truly find out if it's enough. The center console definitely gives me Model S vibes again. I'm sure it's had these hideaway compartments before. They've also dropped a USB-C port in the center console, and I guess the usage data Tesla has suggests it just wasn't being used. I don't use mine, but maybe you might. The center dash and door trims are giving me that premium up vibe again. We've gained back that passenger lumbar support again, and the ventilated seats are a big, big win here. This was a headline Model S feature. To introduce this, as well as the rear screen, for which I'll get into in a moment, is big. It makes the jump to the Model S much less convincing if it has these features for a lower price. Obviously, there are Model S features that make it attractive, but these were two mega features that make the Model 3 so much more feature-packed and extremely good value for money for its segment. Literally, who else has ventilated seats and a rear display for £42,000? That rear display controls ventilation, plays games, video apps, etc. You can even move the front seats from the rear now. The rear seats aren't ventilated, but they are heated. They've made the back row more comfortable now, and the armrest is longer and more practical for use now. All the Model 3 glass is now double glazed to help reduce road noise, and the material changes such as carpet in the door pockets has been introduced under the premium up logic mentioned earlier, but to achieve a much more sound, secluding experience. The legend Bjorn thinks it puts it very much in line with the German powerhouse brands. The doors now have this new anchor point, and this helps with safety, alignment, and reduce cabin noise again. Nice. Other notable changes include better Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and microphone experience. The glove box is actually smaller though, but this does give a bit more passenger room apparently, and it's now magnetized, which again, that more premium than a latch, right? I did actually also see a screenshot on the connectivity of the car, and the car does not actually show 5G, so maybe 4G is still the fastest mobile connectivity, for now at least. Okay, so now you're pretty hyped about the whole thing. When is this being delivered to the US, the UK, and Europe? Well, my European friends have been told October to November, and you can make your order today over on the configurator. Us Brits, though, have to wait a little longer. I did some probing of my own, though, and I was told by a third-party lease operator to expect it around the summer of 2024 in the UK.
He's joking.
However, I wasn't fully convinced by that, as Australia and Japan have Q1 2024 as its estimated delivery dates, so the right-hand drive production lines will be up and pumping cars out. The UK is a fairly big market, so I'm speculating that the lack of clarity on the UK Tesla website is simply just to clear out the existing Model 3 stock today in readiness for that Q1 delivery push. My friends across the pond, however, it's not quite clear as to when the Model 3 is coming. They were clearly testing the vehicles in the months leading up to the announcement, so I expect nothing is official until the Cybertruck deliveries and specs have been released in order just to prevent the thunder being stolen from it. So I expect deliveries to commence soon, but we won't truly know until the website goes live with the new trim. Shout out to any folks in Australia. I do look forward to seeing your hands-on videos over the next couple of months. So to conclude, this new Model 3 announcement has surpassed my expectations. There were some very big surprises, particularly the interior changes have really got me hyped for this new Model 3. I'm potentially looking at getting a new car some point next year, and initially, with the kids getting a little bit older, I was actually gravitating to the Model Y, as is the wife. However, this has put a real spanner in the works, hasn't it? I think this really goes to show that Tesla does monitor the data, it listens to negative customer feedback, and I know it doesn't really feel that way sometimes, and being critical about Tesla can be challenged. But credit due, it's reassuring that Tesla does listen to those critical of its cars. It isn't them making changes and just jacking up the prices in line with inflation like some cars on the market today. You're getting more mileage, lower running costs, more practicality, more luggage space, and a more comfortable driving experience, all for around the same price. I simply can't wait to get my hands on a test drive and see it in the flesh. I'm really digging the new ultra red colour. The new stealthy grey though looks very similar to the existing grey to me. But what do you guys think? Have Tesla done a good job at the refresh? And is there anything you don't like? I'm not going to shoot you down in the comments. I really just want a broad church of opinions here. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and share the video with any friends and family that like Tesla content like this. You folks have been great, and I'll see you in the next one. Ciao.